in some quarters is met with violence and retaliation rather than conversation and vigorous debate. Yet on the other hand, it's also clear that Christians in Western traditions need to be circumspect and self-critical before indiscriminately blaming Muslims as a whole, as I say, for intolerance. And this includes even criticizing moderate Muslim leaders for not taking a more dramatic stand against violence by fellow Muslims. An accusation, I think, that the 2006 Amman message dramatically discredits, just in the very fact that it's it was an effort to speak to stem the violence among Muslims in the Muslim world. In fact, it's signed over by over 500 prominent leaders. So this message even itself goes against the stereotypes of Islam as a violent religion. So Christians need a good amount of self-critical awareness to ensure that polemics and vitriolic and unwarranted double standards are not advanced under the banner of Christianity. So speaking tonight as a Christian theologian, and one who's deeply engaged in efforts to build bridges of peace and dialogue among traditions, I'd like to reflect on some contemporary challenges to dialogue and misconceptions that arise that prevent honest dialogue. Is it possible for Christians and Muslims to engage one another constructively within a context influenced by extremism, by reactionary and militant forms of Islam, as well as by Christianity's complicity in colonialism and nationalist ideologies and global frameworks of empire that displace and marginalize? Is it possible? Well, I spend my time wagering that it is, and I hope to suggest some possibilities, because it's not just a wager, but we must wager in order to make it so. And so I'm particularly grateful for being invited to be with you and talk about the importance of Muslim-Christian dialogue. So I'm going to basically outline three points, three steps, and then in that process kind of highlight some of the misconceptions that arise out of these three points, which I think are conditions for so many of the problems that there and impasses that there have been in Muslim Christian dialogue. I don't want to necessarily list the misconceptions in a boring sequence, but as I said, kind of get at what's at stake here. And the first point I want to make is to underscore the public importance of religion. The public importance of religion. It's important for leaders of all kinds to encourage governments to take religion seriously. As theologian, Catholic theologian, Hans Küng states, there can be no peace among nations unless there's peace among religions. And we can imagine why. Because religions motivate people to do amazing, compassionate things, and also motivate people, in some cases, to violent behaviors. Religious traditions appeal to deep-seated beliefs and core values. But precisely this point is often neglected in creating public arenas of debate and dialogue, as well as in making foreign policy. This neglect fits well, rather, with the common belief that religion is not a matter of state, but an individual affair confined to private feelings, just me and my relationship with God. That religion should be kept out of public life, because when it does so, it creates problems. John Locke, a famous philosopher, proposed that in countering the religious strife of the European wars, advocated a political peace that involves separating the spheres of faith from the spheres of the state. And following Locke, Thomas Jefferson of the US, a famous writer of the Declaration of Independence, called for a wall of separation between religion and government and state. Why? Because a thick boundary is needed to protect democracy from religion. It's as if religion is going to be divisive no matter how you spin it. And this is the kind of presupposition that often happens in the making of foreign policy in a variety of ways. It's assumed that when religion becomes political, it becomes oppressive. And so it's better to keep it private as your own affair. It's often virtually a truism now, virtually taken for granted in modern Western-style universities, that religion actually is the sideline creation or byproduct of other kinds of ideologies. Karl Marx famously said, religion is the opium of the people. It's used to oppress. And this fits in well with the kind of prejudice against religious traditions that's often assumed by our political leaders. And the overall result trivializes the power of religion to shape us. It suggests that while religious traditions might be visible players on the surface of events, the real show needs to go on somewhere else. In making peace, we don't need to talk to religious leaders, and they don't need to talk to them among themselves, but political leaders need to do that work. That's kind of the assumption that's at stake, and we see it played out in the way that our governments operate in a variety of ways without consulting religious leaders. Accordingly, the public influence of Muslim and Christian faiths are minimized. In fact, equally trivializing when Muslim and Christian faiths are taken seriously, they're usually taken seriously for their negative, divisive elements, whether it's creating economic disparities or whether voicing historic resentments of one group over and against another, or perhaps the hunger for prestige and influence, because religion should be kept out as it's violent. I don't want to deny the powerful influence of sometimes negative motivations, but I do think this affects the troubled history of Muslim-Christian relations. One has only to think of Nigeria, for example, present-day Nigeria, where a predominantly Muslim northern region resents the prosperity of an oil-rich and Christian southern region, and the violence is growing. So there's more at stake there than just religion. But it's often religion that gets the attention and blamed as if it needs to be suppressed. I want to claim that it's a mistake not to address religious traditions as possible actors in the making of peace. Issues around Jerusalem, for example, as a holy site, involve religious dimensions that need to be taken seriously. Missionary endeavors need to be taken seriously by political leaders because they do foment and create unrest and resentments. The modern presumption I'm criticizing seems to be at work here in an assertion that equality, freedom, and democracy are gifts that the West offers that will automatically be embraced by Muslim populations across the world once they get a real taste of it. This is a kind of arrogance that simply assumes a kind of European understanding of liberal democracy. And this understanding puts religion in a private sphere. This is an effrontery, as I understand it, to many Muslim communities who, on the basis of Islamic precepts, can accept neither the separation of church and state nor the privatization of religion that those in Western traditions have come for good and bad, I think, to take for granted as part of liberal democracies. So there's a lot of assumptions. There are a lot of assumptions that take place and therefore cause difficulties in the engagement of Muslims and Christians in this broader political framework. Not that democracy is incompatible with Islam, but that its particular meaning, along with accompanying notions of equality and freedom, will differ when understood in Islamic contexts. Why? Because religious notions rooted in Quranic and Islamic jurisprudence drive the way people in Muslim communities think about these terms. In fact, in my studies, I've discovered that Islam has a long history of government by community consensus, ijma, according to rational interpretation of Quranic and Islamic traditions, ijtihad. Thus, not paying attention to religion misses these long-standing traditions that are operative and actually reflect positive possibilities for engagement. In fact, and I'll push further here, the very word that we often use, it's kind of the religious E word, extremism. It fits with fundamentalism. Extremism, the way we use that word, even illustrates the point. The term has become commonplace these days, especially in the media, to connote a radicalized and overtop form of life that's threatening. But threatening to whom, I want to ask? Often the label extremist is employed in an effort to stereotype religion we don't like. Those people over there. Like the word fundamentalist, which has a history in describing certain Christian groups, and it's wrongly used in an interfaith context. Fundamentalism has a particular history in North American Protestantism. So it's wrongly used, but it's always used as a pejorative term that distances and sets apart those other people, unlike my religious faith and community. Those people outside the taken-for-granted norms of our social order and its perceived peaceful practices. What I'm calling this distancing move, the pushing away, could sometimes be called othering. It makes other and strange and pushes away as something unlike us who are considered normative. And this separation, we can see the result of it. The term extremism thus perhaps says more about our own fears of difference than it does about different religious groups. Such a distancing move, which implies other terms like fanatic, terrorist, ignorant, superstition, and so forth, says a lot about our own ideals and values. Now, I don't here intend to condone violence. That's not what I'm saying. But what I am saying is these words often operate in the media to galvanize public opinion in a way that damages Muslim-Christian relations, both in Europe and in North America. You can just read the newspaper, the Star, the Globe and Mail. Often the terms work in certain ways. So I encourage you to watch how the words function in ways to separate people into opposing groups. There's a real danger here in adopting the word extremism. Now, there are some Muslim groups, those of the Wahhabi heritages and so forth, that do opt for an oppositional posture as opposed to everything else and brand it anything in opposition un-Islamic. But we need to find words, I suggest, that are less